I'm Emily, and today I'm going to show you a fun experiment that you can do at home, featuring a very special ingredient called yeast. Now, if you've ever eaten a deliciously light and airy loaf of bread, you've enjoyed the products of yeast's hard work. Yeast is a key ingredient in many kinds of baking because it helps dough to rise. It can do that because it is alive! Compared to you and I, it's a simple living thing, but inside that yeast, lots of things are happening, and it's making chemicals that's telling us it's alive. Every individual yeast is only one cell big. Cells are the building blocks of all living things. You and I are made up of trillions and trillions of cells of all different shapes and sizes. Like all living things, yeast likes to be comfortable. It likes a lot of food and a nice, cozy, warm temperature. And we're going to do an experiment to find out the best setup for our yeast to thrive. We're going to blow up this balloon with the power of yeast. Here are all the things that you need to try this experiment out at home. First up, we have a clock so that we can time our experiment. I'm using the stopwatch on my phone. We also have a pen and paper so we can write down our results. Some plastic bottles, a measuring tape. If you don't have one at home, you can just use a piece of string and a ruler to do the same sort of job. A few balloons, some warm water, some sugar, and finally, our yeast. Now, this is baker's yeast, which you can find in the baking section of the supermarket. So, let's get cracking with our experiment. First of all, we want to stretch out the balloon just so our yeast doesn't have too hard of a job. And now blow it up. Take your plastic bottle and pour in the warm water to about the 3 centimeter high mark. Next, you need to get your baker's yeast ready. So I'm going to use directly from the sachet just because it's a little bit easier to pour. So I'm going to pour it into the drinks bottle and swirl the bottle to mix it together. Next, we add 1 teaspoon of sugar and swirl the bottle again. The sugar is food for the yeast, just like how we need food to fuel our bodies. What's next? Well, we're gonna have to add our balloon over the top. So, nice and stretched out from blowing it up earlier, let's add this on. We've set up the first part of our experiment. The water has woken up the yeast and it's started feasting on all the sugar. Now we're going to wait for about an hour to see how much the balloon blows up. So I'm going to start my 60 minute timer now. And I'm going to call this test 1 teaspoon sugar. And I'm going to write this down in my notebook. I'm writing it down because we want to see what conditions yeast does best in. So our experiment needs a few different versions so that we can compare the results. I think it would be interesting to see how much sugar the yeast needs for fuel. So I'm going to set up another version where I add no sugar to the mix, and another version where I add 2 teaspoons of sugar, and another version where I add a whopping 10 teaspoons of sugar. So we'll be back in 1 hour. We're ready to look at the results of our experiment, and I've brought along my friend Sarah, who works with yeast in the lab. Hello, Sarah.
Hi, Emily.
So, we're back. This is our experiment.
It looks great.
I'm so glad you think so, Sarah, considering that you are the expert when it comes to yeast.
Yes.
But like all good scientists, shall we write down our results?
Yes.
And make our observations?
Yes, exactly.
So, our first bottle here with the orange balloon, this has no sugar, and you might have been able to guess that from the fact that there's like a little bit of froth, but it hasn't really filled up the bottle. So we're going to measure the widest part of the balloon so I can note that down in my notebook. So would you mind giving me a hand, Sarah?
Yeah, sure.
So that is 21. So I'm gonna write that down. So this is our second balloon, our pink balloon, and this has 1 tablespoon of sugar in. So measurement number 2. All right, that one was 35. All right, number three.
So this is the 2 teaspoons of sugar.
Yes, that's correct.
So we can see this one's almost completely full, but there's still a little bit of space in the bottle. So should we measure it?
Yes, let's give it a go. Would you like to do the honors?
Oh yes, yeah. I'll do my best.
What are the scores?
38.
Ooh, okay, so yes. It is a little bit bigger then. The final balloon, the purple balloon. Do you want to make a guess how much sugar I put in this one?
4, 5?
Bit higher.
10?
10, yeah, that's right.
That
10
is a lot.
Teaspoons of sugar.
So this should be the biggest balloon.
Well, shall we test our guess?
Absolutely.
All right, would you like to do the honors?
Yes.
Okay.
Why not? Ooh. It is 40.
So it is the biggest balloon. Our guess was correct.
Yippee!
We've talked about how yeast needs energy to make all of the chemicals do all of the things it needs to do to survive, and how it unlocks that energy from the sugar that it feeds on. These blown up balloons are proof that it has happened. Yes! Because when yeast does this, one of the things it makes is something called carbon dioxide gas. The gas has filled up the bottle and blown up the balloon. This process is called respiration. So, Sarah, I have a question for you. Is the release of this gas kind of like the yeast is farting?
No, it's more like the yeast is breathing. So, like us, yeast respires. Respiration happens in all cells of all living things, including our cells. So we breathe out carbon dioxide into our environment, like the yeast does.
So we're really not that different to yeast?
Yeah, we're not. And that's why we use it in the lab to study how cells work.
So with that in mind, and everything we've just found out, what can it tell us about the experiment? I'm interested in the purple balloon. So this balloon, it had 10 teaspoons of sugar, so it had the most fuel. Therefore, it created the biggest balloon, which had the most carbon dioxide.
Exactly.
That brings us on to the yellow and the pink balloons. And although the yellow balloon had twice the amount of sugar, it wasn't twice the size of the pink balloon.
Yes, exactly. And even though the purple balloon had 10 teaspoons of sugar, it isn't 10 times the size of the pink balloon, which only has 1 teaspoon of sugar.
So this brings us to our last bottle. And this was a little bit of a surprise to me because we didn't put any sugar in this one. However, the balloon has blown up a little bit, which suggests there is carbon dioxide present. Why do you think that might be, Sarah?
Yeah, so some of the baker's yeast that you can buy in the shops actually comes with some sugar in it already to help you with the baking. So that could explain why there is some carbon dioxide being made, but in comparison to the other balloons, it's barely blown up.
Oh, that makes sense now. So what you're saying is there was a tiny bit of sugar in this one, but nowhere near as much as the other ones where they had a lot more sugar to fuel the yeast. Well, I don't know about you guys at home, but I found that very fun. So why stop there? When you try this out yourself at home, you can experiment with lots of different things. Maybe see what happens if you leave a bottle in the fridge or next to a warm radiator to see if the temperature makes a difference. Or experiment with different types of sugar, like honey. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Take care. Bye.